Good morning and welcome to the online services for Redeemer Christian Church. Today is a very special day. It's a holy day of the Christian calendar known as Pentecost Sunday. Today is the day where we set aside some time to especially be thankful for the precious gift that is God the Holy Spirit given to the church. Over 2,000 years ago, on the very first Easter Sunday, Jesus Christ rose from the grave. And for the next 40 days, he appeared to his disciples, teaching them about the kingdom of God and preparing them for the mission of the church. But then he ascended to the right hand of the Father in heaven. And as he did so, he commanded his people to not do anything before they received the promise of the Father. He actually commanded his disciples, despite all the things that they already knew, all the ways that they had walked with him, to stay put in Jerusalem until God the Holy Spirit was sent to fill them and empower them. And so, on that very first Pentecost day, 2,000 years ago, as the Jewish people were celebrating the Feast of Weeks, it was time for the Holy Spirit to come. The disciples, the first 120 Christians, were gathered in an upper room, and the Holy Spirit fell from heaven. It descended like fire, appearing like tongues of flaming fire above their heads. And they went forth speaking the gospel, testifying to the works of Jesus Christ, even in various foreign languages that they had not been instructed in. When the people of Jerusalem heard the first Christians speaking in these unknown languages, they began to marvel at what was happening before them. But some of them began to mock, assuming that these first Christians were drunk. But the Apostle Peter stood with the other 11 apostles and began to preach one of the most history-shaping sermons in the world. And what is going to follow this moment is a sample of that sermon spoken by various members of our congregation in various languages that they know. And so I encourage you on this Sunday morning to allow these words to call you to worship today, to call us to be a people that worship in spirit and in truth.
God he talk. Close to the last day by me cup sighting spirit blow me long all get a man Mary. Now picking any man, now picking any Mary blow you pla. By outing talk below me or some prophet. Now young pala man below you pala by looking or something or some dream on. Now lapon man by dream on. Now this pala time by me capsizing spirit below me long all walk boy and all walk merry below me. Now by all outing talk below me or some prophet.
At magpapakita ako ng mga kababalaghan sa langit sa itaas at mga tanda sa lupa at sa ibaba. Dugo at apoy at singaw ng usok. 20. Ang araw ay magiging kadiliman at ang buwan ay dugo. Bago dumating ang araw ng Panginoon, yung araw na dakila at tanig.
Y sucederá que todo aquel que invoque el nombre del Señor será salvado.
Muži izraelští, slyšte tato slova. Ježíše Nazaretského Bůh potvrdil před vašimi zraky mocnými činy, divy a znameními, která mezi vámi skrze něho činil, jak sami víte. Bůh předem rozhodl, aby byl vydán a vy z toho rukou bezbožných přibyli na kříž a zabili.
خدا درهای موت را گذشته او را برخیزانید زیرا محال بود که موت او را در بند نگه دارد. آمین.
Hallo, wohin ob der rechte Hand vom Gott erheischen as. An hört vom Pop de versprechen ob der helle Geist kriegt. Hört hin das ausgeliefert. Bei dir allo gesehen an hört.
Nasoma kutoka kitabu cha Nintendo sura 2 aya 36. Watu wote wa Israeli wanapaswa kufahamu kwa hakika kwamba huyo Yesu mlemsubulisha nini ndiye huyo ambaye Mungu amemfanya kuwa Bwana na Kristo.
And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, and for your children, and for all who are far off. Everyone.
Holy, 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 Lord God.
Again, welcome to the online services of Redeemer Christian Church. Redeemer Christian Church exists to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ with our words and to display the gospel of Jesus Christ with our lives to our neighbors and to the nations. Even in this time of coronavirus, the mission of God has gone forth from our local church. One of the things that we believe about our God is that He is a radically generous God. And one of the ways that we worship our God is with our acts of generosity. And I want you to know that our church has been able to be radically generous in this time. We've been able to serve our city. We have been able to serve our brothers and sisters in Christ in the nations of this world. In fact, since the time that this pandemic has begun, our church has been able to give away over $80,000 to be able to help those who have been most impacted by this global pandemic. We have been able to partner with local organizations like Snack Pack for Kids. We've been able to partner with local organizations like High Plains Food Bank. We've been able to also partner with international organizations like Christian Relief Fund and Crisis Aid to be able to serve those that are hungry. We've also been able to partner with organizations like Acts 29 and the Church in Hard Places Initiative and the Rural Collective to be able to partner with local churches that are serving the most affected communities in our world. It's a great privilege to be able to be a part of the mission of God, and for our church to be able to generously give this much in this season really is a display of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so I want to thank you. Thank you if you have given to support our mission. It really has not just affected lives here in our city, but it's been able to impact lives all across this world. If you want to partner with us in that mission, I encourage you to be able to give financially. You can give online at RedeemerChristianChurch.com. You can also text Redeemer Gives to 77977. You can also even mail in a check to our physical property at 3701 South Sauncey, zip code 79119 here in Amarillo, Texas. Every dollar that is given is able to resource the mission of God going forward in this very crucial time. And so we encourage you, we welcome you to be a part of that. One part of our mission that's going to get to go forward in profound ways here pretty soon is that we are bringing on a brand new church planting resident. At Redeemer Christian Church, one of our core values is that we really do believe that we want to be a church that not only grows our local church, we want to be a church that multiplies. We want to be able to plant other churches that go forward and plant other churches. So we're bringing on a new church planting resident that's from Amarillo, Texas. He's just finished up his degree from Westminster Theological Seminary in Philadelphia, and his name is J.R. Favela. I'd like you to meet him right now.
Good morning, Redeemer. We hope you guys are doing well. For those who may not know us, my name is JR and this is my beautiful wife, Megan.
Hi, everyone.
And we wanted to make this short video to let you guys know how excited we are to be joining the Redeemer family through this church planting residency. I'm Amarillo born and raised, But for the past 4 years, I've been living in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where I've been given the chance to meet my beautiful wife and also finish up my MDiv degree at Westminster Theological Seminary. But for the past 2 years, we've both been preferably considering the type of ministry that the Lord would have for us and also where would he like us to be. And in this time of ministry, we've seen the Lord put particular callings in both of our lives. For me, I grew up in Amarillo and got to see the gospel transform multiple sections of the city. And it's through that that a love for community engagement and for church planting was produced.
And for me, my background's in music education, and through an opportunity serving with a missions organization in Uganda for a year, and now for the past 2 years on staff at our church in Philly, God's really grown a love for using music in ministry, cross-cultural work, and the local church.
So we were really excited when the Lord opened up a door for us to go to Amarillo. Amarillo has actually become one of the most strategic places for a church plant. The population's about 43% Latino or Hispanic, and it hosts one of the largest communities of refugees in the state of Texas, with over 70 languages being spoken in the northeast section of the city. Legitimately, if we reach Amarillo, we can now reach the nations with the hope of Christ's life, death, and resurrection. God has sovereignly brought the nations to Amarillo's doorsteps, and we are so excited about that.
We are really looking forward to partnering with you all in ministry, and we can't wait to get to meet you in person in a few short months. And in the meantime, we would love to invite you to partner with us in a few different ways. First, we really covet your prayers as we're preparing for this move and for this next season of ministry.
Lastly, we would love for you to preferably consider partnering with us financially. We've begun already fundraising for this ministry, and we're believing that the Lord will provide partners who want to see the Amarillo saturated with the gospel. If you would like to get to know us a little bit more or would like more information on how you can partner with us, we will see you after service on the online Zoom call. Redeemer, we love you guys and we're so excited to be joining you all. God bless.
If you would like to have a chance to meet JR today, I encourage you to be able to stick around and join us for our digital four-year that will happen immediately after this service. It's going to start about 11 a.m. this Sunday morning. We just are so excited that we get to bring JR. I've been prayerfully pursuing JR because I believe that he has a call to be able to plant a church, and I'm excited that our church gets to partner with him in this season. And so, JR and Megan, we love you guys. We're excited to be able to partner with you in this next season. So without any further ado, I would invite you on this Pentecost Sunday to be able to open your Bibles to the book of Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4, our reading is going to be from Proverbs chapter 4, beginning in verse 20, and we're going to read through verse 27. My son, be attentive to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Let them not escape from your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and healing to all their flesh. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Put away from you crooked speech, and put devious talk far from you. Let your eyes look directly forward, and your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet, then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. This is God's holy word. Thanks be to God. Almighty and everlasting God, we ask for your grace to be upon us today. Give us grace to order our lives in such a way that we would be a people that live for your glory. Help us to see what you see. Help us to love what you love. Help us to have ears that hear what your voice is saying to us today. Lord, help us to respond to the leading of your Holy Spirit as we seek to be a people that live faithfully in an age of anxiety and anger. Lord, help us to bear witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior. It is in his mighty name that we pray. Amen. We are in a transitional moment as a people, as individuals, as families, as a church, and even as a society. We are in this moment where we are transitioning out of one phase into another. Kids are out of school. Workers are beginning to return back to work. There are things that are beginning to open up. Nevertheless, we do live in a moment of a fog of uncertainty, where we are very much uncertain about the future that lies ahead of us. Expert sea captains will tell you that whenever your ship enters into a fog, you have to be mindful of the challenge that lies around you. You have to slow down. You have to pay very close attention with your eyes to your surroundings. Most of all, you have to be deliberate in your actions and your choices if you want to find your bearing and make your way to a safe haven. We too are navigating through a type of fog. Many of our long-term plans feel contingent and uncertain. What will the summer look like? What will the fall look like? What will school look like next year? What will our economy look like? Will there be another surge of COVID-19? And if there is, how will our society then respond to it? The truth is, we don't know. However much we might want things to be back to normal, our lives aren't normal yet, and they might not be for some time. Our rhythms are off. Our routines are off. And many of us feel that as individuals, communities, and as a society, we are off kilter. And if we're not careful, this season of fog has the capacity to make a shipwreck of our faith. And so today is Pentecost Sunday, and it's a day that we joyfully celebrate the giving of God the Holy Spirit to us as a church. So I thought it was appropriate on this day to take a bit of a Spirit-led detour, to be able to enter into a moment of intermission where we pause our study of the New Testament book of 1 Peter and offer a bit of a pastoral word of exhortation and encouragement for this particular season. I want to address this fog of confusion, of exhaustion and frustration that many of us feel in this present moment. And I want to encourage us to turn to the wisdom of God's word, particularly to the book of Proverbs. As we look to our text today from Proverbs chapter 4, I want to examine four simple commands that are profoundly true and profoundly important in this season that we're living in now. The first of these commands is to keep your heart. Verse 23 of our reading today says, "Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life." I remember hearing this verse as I grew up in the church. Typically, I would hear it in youth ministry, and it was in the context of taking things slow and steady as you entered into a dating relationship. But as I've read the Bible and as I've come to know more about the gospel of Jesus Christ, I really do believe that this is one of the most important verses in the entire book of Proverbs. This is a verse that contains truth, not just for dating, but for the entirety of the Christian life. In fact, I think that this verse contains one of the most important corrective truths to our modern post-Enlightenment era. In the time of the Enlightenment, there was a French philosopher named René Descartes who wanted to find a firm foundation that all of truth could be able to rest upon. He believed that the religion of the church and even the scientific observations of man were not firm enough foundations for the reality of all human truth to rest upon. René Descartes was so radical that he even doubted his own existence. He believed that really the only thing that was certain was the fact that he was thinking. He could not deny the fact that he was thinking with his mind, and so that was going to be his firm foundation for truth. He came up with this famous slogan that he wrote down that you've probably heard before. That slogan is, "I think, therefore I am." Now, whether or not you've ever heard of the philosopher René Descartes, or even if you agree with his ideas, I guarantee you that you have been formed and influenced by his ideas. Ever since the time of the Enlightenment, most people in the Western world think of themselves as primarily thinking creatures. We want to change the way that we act. We have to change the way that we think. And so we try to find a blog or a book that we need to read to be able to give us the magical answer, to think a new way so that our lives can change. But according to the Bible, that is an incomplete and flawed notion of the human person. For the Bible, the center of the person is not the mind, but the heart. We are not primarily what we think. We are what we love. We are desiring creatures. Our desires form our thoughts. Our thoughts form our actions, and our actions form our lives. Therefore, it is of first importance to keep our hearts with all vigilance, for from our hearts flow the springs of life. The image that is evoked here in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 is that of a watchman guarding a city wall. In the same way that an ancient watchman would watch over a walled city, we are to actively and routinely be on the lookout against anything that would compromise the health or the well-being of our hearts. We are to act mindfully and vigilantly as we examine what comes in and out of our hearts. But can we honestly say that we are mindful enough to be able to observe the condition of our hearts on a regular basis? How often are we truly willing to be still enough to engage the often painful work of self-examination? And if we happen to achieve an awareness of the deepest desires of our heart, how often are we really willing to critique those desires? How often do we instead run to someone or something that validates us in whatever we might desire? But here, the Word of God reminds us that we need the stillness, the silence that we can only achieve before the presence of our God, before the truth of His Word, so that we can reflect, so that we can repent, and so that we can embrace the grace of transformation. What have you allowed your heart to desire? We might intellectually believe that the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. We might have this perfect, pristine, gospel-laden theology that we are willing to be able to articulate with great clarity and fervor. But when we look at our lives, when we look at our habits, our inner dialogue, our functional priorities, they reveal that our hearts are truly allegiant to other lesser gods. The god of being perceived as significant, or smart, or desirable, or powerful. The god of feeling like I am in control. The god of seeking comfort. The god of seeking wealth. Be honest with yourself. What have you trained your heart to desire? And even more, for the parents of our church, what are you actively training your children to desire? What are you teaching your children in this season of uncertainty and stress about that which is most important in life? Parents, your children need to understand that things like athletic achievement, things like academics, like body image, like popularity, these things can be good things, but they can never be ultimate things. They can never save our souls. Train your children, by example, parents, to desire the Lord, to be able to desire to dwell in His house and to gaze upon His beauty, to be able to abide in Him, to glorify Him, and to enjoy Him forever, not just with your words, but with your life. Point number two is put away crooked speech. According to the Bible, our words matter. Words in general matter because the very cosmos, the very totality of being and existence are rooted in the power of God's spoken word. The very first page of the Bible reminds us, and God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Men and women are created in the image and likeness of God. And as creatures made in God's image, we have this unique and extraordinary capacity for language. Now, there is a distinction here. Our words are nowhere in the same universe of power as our Creator, but our words are powerful nonetheless. Thus, we are commanded, put away from you crooked speech and put devious talk far from you. I want to consider this text from two different angles, external words and internal words. Firstly, what are the external words that you are listening to, that you're allowing your heart to be exposed to? I've heard that you cannot possibly out-exercise a bad diet. And I believe in the same way that we cannot spiritually out-exercise a mental diet of images and words and sources that lead us to anger, toward fear, toward lust, or to entertainment-sedated apathy. Most healthy people would recognize that you have to be able to put some realistic limit on how much fast food you're going to allow yourself to eat, how much candy you're going to allow yourself to eat. I wonder, have you ever thought about limiting how much media that you're going to allow your mind to be able to intake? Have you thought about maybe putting a cap on how much social media you're going to allow yourself to be able to be engaged in? Have you thought about limiting the amount of entertainment or television that you watch? Have you thought about limiting the amount of news that you need to be exposed to on a daily basis? Have you considered those sources? And specifically, the words that come from those sources might be forming your soul to be more concerned with the things of this world than the things of God. If you're in the habit of reading social media and engaging the news and checking your email from the moment that you awaken from sleep, you need to realize that the way that you interpret your reality for the rest of the day will be through the lenses that you just engaged. Whenever we are looking at these habits, we need to understand that they are not just neutral habits. They are in the same realm as spiritual disciplines. This is why I commend to you so fervently to adopt a daily rhythm of reading the Word of God and engaging the Lord in prayer. It's so crucial that we do this, not because we're trying to earn extra points of favor with God, but whenever we engage the Word and whenever we pray on a regular basis, especially when we begin our days engaging the Lord, we are allowing ourselves to interpret our reality through the framing reference of God's truth and the grace of His presence. We need the Holy Spirit to be able to give us eyes to see ourselves, to see our world, to see God and our story in light of God's redemptive plan for history, that we are participants in God's story. We are a part of what He is doing in the world. We need the peace that passes all understanding when we acknowledge the sovereignty and the power of our holy God. We need to remind our hearts of His goodness, His mercy, and His grace on a daily basis. And if you need a place to start, I would encourage you to participate in reading our daily reading plans that we have emailed out to our church on a daily basis. We have scripture references. We even have prayers that we have sent to the members of our congregation and the regular attendees of our congregation to be able to help spur them on in this practice of spiritual discipline. We are to be a people that draw near to the Lord, and knowing that when we draw near to God, He draws near to us. But whatever you do, be consistent with these spiritual disciplines. Put away crooked speech. Put away deceitful speech. And be attentive to the word of the Lord. But before we move on to this next point, I do want to consider the power not just of external words, but of internal words. The words that we speak to ourselves. Because if you think about it, no one talks to you more than you do. And the power of our inner dialogue really is formative. It helps form the type of person that we're becoming. And so I wonder, if you were to read a transcript of your inner dialogue, what would it sound like? For some of you, your inner dialogue is not self-condemnation, but rather self-justification. You're constantly thinking about how other people have it wrong, about how other people have wronged you and hurt you, and how they're the ones that have it all wrong. You're constantly judging people and being bitter towards them because it's so hard for you to be able to acknowledge any failure that you might be responsible for. And in that place of bitterness, you have led your heart to a place to where it cannot enter joy and it cannot enjoy peace. It never allows us to be at a place where we find rest in our soul. So rather than these temptations towards self-condemnation or self-justification, we need to embrace the art of preaching the gospel to ourselves. The gospel of Jesus Christ proclaims to us that our sin was so great that it merited the death of God. But the gospel also reminds us that the love of God was so great that He was willing to pay that cost for our redemption. When we preach this gospel to ourselves, we are preaching to ourselves the truth that we have been fully known, even in the midst of our sin, but also fully loved. That our God has paid an extraordinary cost to be able to redeem us, love us, and transform us. It's how we are able to know the power of Spirit-led transformation and joy. As the great Protestant reformer Martin Luther once wrote, "The highest of all God's commands is this, that we must ever hold up before our eyes the image of His dear Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. He must daily be to our hearts the perfect mirror, in which we behold how much God loves us and how well, in His infinite goodness as a faithful God, He has grandly cared for us in that He gave His dear Son for us. Do not let this mirror and throne of grace be torn away from before your eyes. Point number three, let your eyes look directly forward. Verse 25, let your eyes look directly forward and your gaze be straight before you. This verse is about the spiritual power of vision. And the author is not talking about just the mere physical faculty of eyesight, but this spiritual vision is the capacity to imagine a better future so that you can make necessary changes in the present to help you get to that better future. Do you have a vision that you proactively seek after? Or have you just gotten stuck in the self-inflicted cycles of sedation and constant reaction? Here, the book of Proverbs challenges us to break out of a way of life that is one constant reaction after another. We are challenged by the Word of God to seek vision for our lives, for our marriages, for our families, for our vocations. Some of you might not even know where to start, and so I want to give to you maybe some questions for self-reflection. Where do you want to go in life? How has God uniquely gifted you? What are your unique desires, abilities, and opportunities? Where are there needs in this world that maybe God has called you to be able to meet those needs? Maybe it seems impossible to imagine a better future right now. Maybe it seems like you can't see what that future might look like or what it would take to achieve that future. And so instead of maybe seeing the big picture, consider setting some short-term goals for yourself. You might not be able to understand how to get from A to Z in your life, but maybe you can prayerfully seek the Lord's wisdom of how to get to A to B. But even more than these practical considerations, how might God be leading you in this season? Today on Pentecost Sunday, we remember that we do not serve a God that is a distant God. We are not deists. We are Trinitarian Christians. We believe that God has sent His Spirit to lead us and to guide us and to interact with us. We believe in the Holy Spirit. So as such, how are we to be a Spirit-led and Spirit-dependent people? Well, I believe that the Holy Spirit does lead His people. He leads us toward repentance. He convicts us of sin that we might turn to Jesus. He leads us in Christ-like righteousness. He leads us towards what it means to be able to worship the Lord in spirit and truth. He leads us to His truth in the Word of God. So what we see when we consider this question from the angle of what the Holy Spirit of God is doing in our lives, that vision is not just about where we want to be in life, but who the Spirit of God is calling us to be in Jesus Christ. And finally, point number four, ponder the path of your feet. If verse 25 teaches us how considering the future gives us insight on how to steward the present, verses 26 and 27 teach us how to consider the present so that we might have insight on how to steward our future. The text says, ponder the path of your feet. Then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. I encourage you in this season to take time to audit some of the habits of your life. Think through the hours of your week and how you spend those hours. Not how you think you should spend them or how you believe you spend them, but really how you spend them. Functionally, what does your life look like? Are your habits taking you to a place that you want to go in life? And even more than that, what type of person are your habits encouraging you to become? Are you sowing into the flesh, or are you sowing into the Spirit? As the Apostle Paul writes to the Galatian church, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good. For in due season we will reap if we do not give up. The British professor and author C.S. Lewis gets at a similar idea when he writes in his book, Mere Christianity, every time you make a choice, you are turning the central part of you, the part of you that chooses, into something a little different than it was before. And taking your life as a whole, with all your innumerable choices, you are slowly turning this central thing into a heavenly creature or a hellish creature. Either into a creature that is in harmony with God and with others and with itself, or else into one that is in a state of war and hatred with God and with its fellow creatures and with itself. Each of us, at each moment, is progressing to one state or the other. Perhaps the most important question I can ask you in relationship to this are the habits of your life leading you to a greater worship of Jesus, to a deeper closeness to Jesus, to a deeper love for Jesus and his people? The pandemic, I have to admit, has been exhausting. It's made us both weary in body and in soul. But what we must know is that true rest is found in Christ alone. To paraphrase the great Augustine of Hippo, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in Christ. We so often seek rest and restoration in things that rob us of joy and of peace. We binge on Netflix. We endlessly scroll through social media. We leave on the TV on a 24-hour news channel because we don't want to miss the latest piece of breaking news. We're consumed with finding activities for our kids, about working out, trying to plan the next holiday, the next big event. We run ourselves weary with work and worry. But it's here in this place, in the place of the fog, that Christ speaks to us. He says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. This is the mystery of our faith. But the mystery of this gospel is not just a historical reality, even though it is the most important thing that has ever happened in reality. It's not just a doctrine, although it is the most important truth you will ever know. The gospel of Jesus Christ is an invitation to participate in the resurrection life of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. So in this time that's filled with death and darkness, we can be a people of resurrection. We can be a people of light. And so, Redeemer Christian Church, on this Pentecost day, let us consider how we might be able to live in light of Christ. May Christ be the desire of our hearts. May he be the proclamation in our mouths, and may he be the vision before our eyes. Amen. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we come before your throne of grace because we are a people that need your grace. Our world is weary and broken, and many of us are weary and broken. This week, we've been reminded by the news that we're not just struggling with a sickness of the body. We are also afflicted with a sickness of the soul. And so we pray that the healing hand of Christ, your Son, would touch us. Heal us of COVID-19. Heal our economy. But even more, heal us of hatred, of division, of racism, and of oppression. Heal us from the dominion of sin that casts such a dark shadow over the nations of this world. But in the midst of this darkness, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. Thank you that the resurrection life of Jesus Christ dwells within us and empowers us. Thank you that your presence and peace abides with us and sustains us. Thank you that you have given our lives meaning and a mission. Lord, help our lives display a shining glimpse of that kingdom that is coming in Jesus Christ. Help us to guard our hearts and be mindful of our words. Help us to see Christ as our vision and to order our steps that we may be more and more like him. We pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's continue our worship today.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never. So I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes.
is failing, it draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Amen. Will Redeemer receive this benediction? May the blessing of the Holy One, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, rest with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Hey, thank you for joining us for worship today at Redeemer Christian Church. It's always great to open the Word of God with you, to sing His praises, and to spend time learning about our Savior Jesus. Following this service, if you're watching at 10 a.m. on Sunday morning, we are going to have that time where you can meet J.R. Favela, our oncoming church planter resident. You can find the link below. It'll be on Zoom. As well, tonight at 6 p.m., our elders are gathering to be able to pray for you or any other needs that may have come up in your community or in your family. And as well, we always want to invite you to join one of our gospel communities. You can find more information, like time or place, at RedeemerChristianChurch.com. Redeemer, we love you. Have a blessed week.